Namaskar. Good evening once again. Welcome to every one of you on behalf of the Bombay Management Association. Today's distinguished guest for the evening is a person who has done India proud, not only within the country, but internationally. I'm delighted to welcome in our midst Padma Vibhushan, Dr. R. Chidambaram. Namaskaram, sir, and welcome to the Bombay Management Association. It's our honor and privilege that you agreed to be in our midst this evening and share some of your thoughts on a very, very important topic of how we need to move towards sustainable development so that India would be regarded as a knowledge economy superpower. Most of us in this audience would have had the opportunity to either have heard Dr. Chidambaram or seen several of his videos and interviews on so many topics of national importance. May I take the liberty of introducing him to all of us by mentioning to you that Dr. Chidambaram was the director of the Bhabha Atomic Research Center, moved on to become the chairman of the Atomic Energy Commission, and subsequently was the principal advisor to the cabinet and also worked with the Prime Minister's offices and ensure that all the policy making in the areas of science and technology were in the safest of hands of Dr. Chidambaram. I'm also very, very happy to share with you that here is a scholar who has been bestowed over 30 doctorate in sciences by universities all over the world on an honorary basis as a sheer recognition of the wonderful knowledge and research that he has done, which has led to over 200 plus publications in journals nationally and internationally. Sir has also been the chairman of the Board of Governors at several IITs over different periods of time, has been awarded several distinguished fellows, has also been bestowed awards of eminence, a doyen of the Indian Nuclear Society, and a leader in the field of nuclear research and space research. Such is a person of eminence we have here this evening. So we are particularly delighted to welcome you to this digital BMA series. When lockdown was imminent, as on April 1st last year, we decided that BMA would go digital. And I'm delighted with the support of everyone present here and many more who are still going to join us. Today is our standalone 100th webinar. And therefore, we thought it would be very, very appropriate that a leading luminary like Dr. Chidambaram would do the honors this evening. Welcome once again, sir. We are looking forward to listening from you and gaining a lot of knowledge here this evening. Over to you, sir, Dr. Chidambaram.
Thank you, Professor Mani. Professor Mani, distinguished presidents and members of the Bombay Management Association and friends. I'm very grateful to Professor Mani for inviting me to give this 100 what he calls Wednesday Wisdom webinar. First, I got a little worried. There are only 52 Wednesdays in a year. But then he has clarified that he compromises a little Wednesdays with Fridays also. So that is how it adds up to 100. Can I have the first slide?
Yes.
I'll make a PowerPoint presentation.
Sure, sir.
See, I chose the topic of today's talk after discussion with Professor Mani. And we want India to become not just a developed country, but a knowledge-driven economy. But this development or the path to the knowledge economy has to be based on sustainable development. Can I have the next? Bombay Management Association, understand, is a very old one, established, the first one actually, Management Association established in India. It's how much now, almost 70 years back, with the mission of helping enhance managerial effectiveness, improving standards of business management. And also, you, I notice you undertake training and development programs. The webinars today has become very popular. And actually, even though it is a nasty pandemic, the popularity of the webinar is a gift of the COVID pandemic. And your dynamic president in his 1 year tenure has created, I think, a world record by organizing, as I said just now, 100 webinars.
Thank you.
100 webinars. And it's my pleasure to give the 100th of them. You know, the United Nations has defined what they call the 17 Sustainable Development Goals. They hope to achieve it by 2030. But then the COVID pandemic has pushed the frontier a little forward. Sustainable development has been defined as development that meets the needs of the present without compromising the ability of future generations to meet their own needs. That's what we mean when we say sustainable development. And the 17 of them, starting with no poverty, zero hunger. Hopefully, if you are not poor, you are not hungry. And then you look after your health. So the third sustainable development goal, good health and well-being. Then you want your children to be educated, quality education, and gender equality, and so on. These are the 17. Then affordable and clean energy. Then you want decent work and so on. These are all part of, I come from the Department of Atomic Energy. And actually, there is no field of social activity from which nuclear is absent in one way or other. Nuclear is not just electricity and nuclear weapons, but you know, we produce radiation mutants. Nuclear plays a very important role in medical diagnostics, treatment of cancer, and so on. Next slide. India for Dreams, particularly the young people in the audience. For us, the UN sustainable goals are only the beginning. We want India to become a developed country, then a knowledge economy. United Nations defines an index called the Human Development Index. We can discuss it in the question session if you like, based on per capita gross national product, level of education, they used to use adult literacy at one time, and life expectancy at birth. I've been saying for a long time, and actually have shown it, that you can redefine the Human Development Index in terms of per capita electricity consumption and female literacy. Female literacy, I have always felt, is a better measure of literacy than adult literacy. Because you take any part of India, wherever the average literacy is lower, the difference between male and female literacy is higher. And India cannot become a developed country unless we become near 100% literate without gender discrimination. And I've also shown that the per capita electricity consumption in India should go up by 6 to 8 times before India can become a developed country. It's a long way for us to go to get this energy security. And this energy security has to be in the context of the ever-growing climate change threat. Want to be scientifically advanced with excellence in basic research, including what I've called directed basic research. It's not directed by anybody, but directed by India's needs in the long term. Applied research, technology development, R&D-led innovation. But all this knowledge you generate will come to naught unless it's backed by high quality manufacturing skills, because knowledge has to be converted into products and processes which create wealth. And this is where the question of technology foresight comes in. I'll show you a slide a little later on that it helps you to select what are the critical technologies for India's rapid development. Militarily strong, with the ability to fight and win conventional wars, crush perpetrators of low intensity conflicts, and with the capability for nuclear deterrence. I'll expand on this a little later. I have always said that national development and national security are two sides of the same coin. And we need high quality leadership. Next one. We were fortunate to have this from our founder, Dr. Homi Bhabha. You know, there is a very interesting book by Arthur Koestler in which he defines two kinds of leaders, the yogi and the kamisa. The yogi is the contemplative thinker and the kamisa is the man of action. Most of us who occupy leadership positions are a mixture of the yogi and the commissar in different proportions. But Bhabha was a unique mixture. And though it is arithmetically absurd, one sometimes thinks that he was 100% yogi and 100% commissar. And he was also a person with great technology foresight. A man who thought of building nuclear reactors in India at a time where we were not even building bicycles indigenously. And you know, there are some leaders, when they pass away, the system collapses. Bhabha created a leadership swarm around him. Vikram Sarabhai, who took over the space program, started in the Department of Atomic Energy. Homi Sethna, Chemical Engineering, Rajaramana, Physics, Brahm Prakash, Metallurgy, A.S. Rao, Electronics. And even though he died suddenly and tragically in an air crash at a very, very early age, the culture he established in the Department of Atomic Energy was sustained. And he helped to bring forward many more leaders in the next generations. Next one, please. Now, this is a very, very interesting field, career leadership. I note that BMA, along with a sister organization, has a program called Leader Next, 4-month transformational leadership program. And the aim is to fast track your professional journey. This is a quote from the, when I went on the web to look at what BMA was doing, and it encompasses 10 futuristic people skills. And today, of course, we need digital skills as defined by the World Economic Forum. Now, this book by Anthony Jay, Management and Machiavelli. Now, leadership goes beyond management. And as Anthony Jay says, leadership needs wisdom, courage. You need deep knowledge. You need lifelong experience. Of course, you need management techniques to lead an organization. But leadership is beyond that, cannot be reduced to a system and incorporated into a manual. And you can't define what are the characteristics of leadership. You've got different kinds of leaders, some good, some bad. But what we are looking for are leaders with character. Einstein was once asked, what is it that makes a great scientist? And his reply was, people think it is the intellect which makes a great scientist. They are wrong, it is character. Not that anybody can do great science, but if you look character and integrity, you can never be a great scientist. Gandhiji calls knowledge without character one of 7 deadly sins. And what Stephen Covey talks about, principle-centered leadership, that of course, we know a little knowledge is a dangerous thing. But what he says is a lot of knowledge without character is even more dangerous. And purely intellectual development without corresponding internal character development makes as much sense as putting a high-powered sports car in the hands of a teenager who is high on drugs. Next slide. I talked about the knowledge economy. Knowledge economy, I define, is an economy which is the ability to generate new knowledge and the ability to appropriate knowledge generated anywhere in the world. That's what the developed countries have done. Anybody generates knowledge, the benefit from them, from that knowledge goes to the already developed countries. And we should learn to do the same thing. Requires excellence in basic research and applied research, technology development and innovation, but it also requires an appetite for risk taking. If you are always going to wait for proven technologies, you can never become a leader. And risks may be economic, scientific, technological, and you cannot always assure success. You're doing things for the first time. Even if you are doing research, taking up a problem for the first time, you can never be sure that you will be successful. But if you are working on an important problem, you rarely go wrong. You may not get what exactly you are looking for, but then you get something which is perhaps equally important. You must have an ability, exceptional ability, to synergize internal capabilities. Capabilities which are dispersed. This is where I coined the phrase called coherent synergy. Synergy in every effort, coherence among all the efforts. And this we must learn to do. At the same time, we must leverage international collaboration. Nobody can work alone in this world today. Even when we talk of self-reliant India, it doesn't mean that we are shunning international collaboration. But as I'll show in the next slide with examples, we want international collaboration on an equal partner basis. We must create manufacturing competence. Make in India has many dimensions. Using indigenous technology for the Indian market. Leverage international collaboration for the Indian market. Of course, you can make for using both of them for the global market. And this for my lecture I gave in BHU, Banaras Hindu University. And today we have to factor in the climate change threat. Next slide. See, low carbon energy technologies, the carbon dioxide that is emitted, and of course there are other greenhouse gases, but the biggest culprit is carbon dioxide from coal-based plants, the other greenhouse gases, they all go and settle upstairs, trap the infrared radiation which is trying to go out from the earth. And that leads to global warming. And what the International Panel on Climate Change in this fifth assessment report, the next one is due now. Warming of the climate system is unequivocal. There are some people who are still skeptics. They are, you know, there is a term called post-truth. The Oxford Dictionary brings out a new word every year. 2016, they brought out this word called post-truth. That means I have made up my mind. Don't confuse me with scientific evidence. That's called post-truth. Atmosphere and ocean, there is plenty of evidence for this. Between the period of the Industrial Revolution and now, started by more than 1 degree, amounts of snow have diminished. Snow is melting, ice has diminished, sea level has risen. And what they say is, if you want to cut down emission of carbon dioxide, you must go in for renewable energy, which is very important, but of course it's intermittent. When the sun is there, you get the energy. Wind is there, you get the energy. But it's very important because you can balance it with other sources of energy. Nuclear, carbon capture and storage, bioenergy. We should forest. Deforestation should be completely avoided, because forests are a good carbon sink. And now they have said that even at that time, originally, they had set the target at 2 degrees. The world should not be allowed to go warmer by 2 degrees. 1 degree is already gone. Now the feeling is better you cut down to 1.5 degrees. And if you look at the many reports, I just put one component of the report relating to our Hindu Kush Himalayan region. 35% of the glaciers in this region could retreat by 2100, even if the global temperature is capped at 1.5 degrees. Next slide. See, these are the nuclear power plants in India. We would like to build many more at various places, Tarapur, Narora, Kakrapar, Kaiga. And the next one, and these are the projects. Next slide, please. These projects under construction. In fact, one of the Kaiga plants was commissioned during the COVID epidemic. All the nuclear power plants had worked very well at high capacity factors during this epidemic. And as I said, one of the 700 megawatt reactors was commissioned during this period, I think, towards December, January. Next one. We cannot shy away from international scientific cooperation, both in basic research and in technology. See, there is this Large Hadron Collider, which is in Geneva, and this became, everybody began, because they use the word, they have found the God particle. So for a very strange reason, it's called the God particle. Actually, it is the Higgs boson. There are two kinds of fundamental particles, fermions and bosons. Anything with spin half, named after Enrico Fermi. Anything with zero or integral spin is named after Satyendranath Bose, who had done pioneering work in this area. That's why they are called a boson. And what they were looking for were the Higgs boson, which is the missing particle in the Indian standard model of the nucleus. You know, when two particles collide, energy disappears. E is equal to mc squared, good old Einstein equation. We produce nuclear energy when mass disappears in the fission of uranium, for example. That mass is converted into energy. Now you read it upside down. Energy disappears, mass is produced. And the higher the energy disappears, higher the energy of the colliding particles, higher is the mass of the particle that you can produce. And in Geneva, Center for European Nuclear Research, they have this Large Hadron Collider 100 meters below the ground, 26 kilometers in circumference, with protons moving in opposite directions. Once in a while, they are brought together and they collide. And when they collide, E and energy disappears, and they knew that the Higgs boson, which had a mass of 130, 150 times the mass of the proton, to produce that, you have to collide particles at 4 tera electron volt at least. 1,000 electron volt is a unit of energy. One electron accelerated through 1 volt, 1 electron volt. Million of them, you call it million electron volt. 1,000 times them, you call giga electron volt. 1,000 times that, you call it tera electron volt, and 1,000,000,000 electron volt. And 4 tera electron volt was the energy they needed, and they found the detector. See, it's a charged particle. It's bent by a magnet so that it can go in a circle. It is focused by what are called corrector magnets, superconducting corrector magnets. And all these superconducting corrector magnets, 1,800 of them were supplied by the Department of Atomic Energy at a cost what they estimated at $40 million. This is what I mean when I say that today we want international collaboration on an equal partner basis. Similarly, international thermonuclear experimental reactor, fusion. Just like your fission, when the uranium breaks up, nucleus breaks up, there is a mass deficit, you get energy. On the other end of the spectrum, when isotopes of hydrogen join together, In that reaction, fusion reaction, there is a loss of energy, and that loss of mass, and that gets converted into energy. And to confine it, for this to happen, we have to take the plasma to 50, 100 million degrees. So there's no question of any material holding it. It has to be held with the plasma, magnetic fields. Next slide. This is the tokamak, which is being built in Cadarache in France. India is a partner. And we are contributing not in cash, but in kind. And one of the big things we are contributing is this cryostat. It is the largest cryostat ever built in the world, which will have the whole tokamak, which is a donut-shaped plasma-containing system. This is being built by L&T, Larsen & Toubro Hazira, under the direction of the Institute of Plasma Research. 30 meters in diameter, 30 meters in height. And the base of this has already been installed in May last year in Cadarache in France. Of course, fusion is a very big challenge for engineers. As I always say, fusion science is a physicist's delight. The phenomenon is so interesting, but the technological challenges are many. Next one, please. It's what I said, national development and national security. I said, national development and national security are two sides of the same coin. Development without security is vulnerable. Security without development is meaningless. And in history, there are examples of this. Greatest advantage or recognized strength is that you don't have to use it. Nobody wants to go and tangle with the well-built fellow or somebody or even a girl. Nobody will approach a girl who knows kung fu and karate. No disagreeable person will bother her. And the greatest disadvantage of perceived weakness is that your enemy may get adventurous. This is the principle between nuclear deterrence, also the principle behind personal deterrence. You must be strong. And that's what, of course, is one dimension. Of course, other dimensions are mentioned in the beginning. Next slide, please. See, nuclear weapons knowledge, this is immediately after, during that year, Payne and McKenzie from the United States came out with the Venn diagram. If you remember your set theory from your school mathematics, you know, will know what is a Venn diagram. Two circles here intersect. Those two countries have shared nuclear weapons knowledge. US and UK work together in the Manhattan Project, so they have mixed them together. US and Russia, nothing to do with spying. After they had, they brought down the SALT negotiations, the number of nuclear weapons. I told them from an absurd astronomical figure to a lower, but equally absurd astronomical figure. I said, we don't even yawn on hearing this. But after that, all the cores of the nuclear weapons, they sold to America without remelting. And if the core has the design, that is what the intersection is about. US and France, France and Israel, Israel and South Africa, sharing of knowledge. Nuclear knowledge went from Russia to China, China to Pakistan. And you see, they have shown my good old India stands alone. They agreed that we didn't spy on anybody, nor did we have to take the help of anybody in developing our nuclear weapons knowledge, and of course now the arsenal. Next one. You know, there's an interesting cartoon which actually precedes the 98 test in the Hindustan Times. And this fellow, who is obviously a Western fellow, telling a fellow with the Gandhi cap who is obviously an Indian, you must not make the bomb. Why do you want the bomb? And the Gandhi cap tells the suited guy, because if I had one, you won't talk to me like this. Next one. See, there is a term used by this very well-known writer, Nassim Nicholas Taleb. He wrote a book called The Black Swan. Black Swan is an unexpected event with disastrous consequences. And he has also written this follow-up book called Anti-Fragile, Things That Gain From Disorder. You know, fragile are things that break down under stress. Robust are things that withstand stress. But he defines this new term, anti-fragile, which gets better and better under stress. For example, microbes, antibiotic-resistant microbes. And I have said in some of my lectures that this is true of a nuclear program. We have resisted and overcome the shocks of technology denial. I remember when I was director of BARC, I used to define self-reliance not as trying to do everything yourself, but as immunity against technology denial. If you're building a complex system and some subsystem is available to you from a reliable source, go ahead and take it. But if anything is denied to you, including the proverbial wheel, you must have the ability to do it yourself. That is what I mean by self-reliance. And that is what we have done in the nuclear program. But today, see, once you become stronger, collaboration starts. The nuclear supply guidelines have been specially relaxed for India. These guidelines were developed for countries which have not signed the NPT. And we are able to source uranium from other countries and also collaborate with other countries. In fact, India and China are the two countries where the nuclear programs are now very robust. And you know, in any technology, if you don't practice it for some time, your knowledge begins to attenuate. Senior people with knowledge retire, and there are no new people with knowledge. And that knowledge is gone forever. That is why I used to tell my Western friends many years back, we need you in the short term, but you are going to need us in the long term, because our knowledge is not getting to be attenuated because we have a strong, sustained nuclear program. Next one. See, look at this. Was the Director General of the International Atomic Energy Agency. He came to India and he said that the remarkable success of India and peaceful nuclear technology is an inspiration for many developing countries and also appreciated. And this is true that India's willingness to serve as a mentor for other developing countries which have recently joined recently joined the IAEA, want to get into the nuclear program. And he has appreciated our three-stage nuclear program. Not going into this, if anybody wants to know, I can tell it about you later. You know, safety and reliability go together. And whether it's your personal car, or a nuclear reactor, if it is performance is reliable, that means your brake system is working, your clutch is working, your steering is working, then very unlikely you'll get into an accident. In a similar way, if you go look at our nuclear program, the indigenously built unit one of the Kaiga reactor broke the world record for continuous operation in December 2018, 941 days previously being held. Normally our capacity factors are very high. Our nuclear reactors work very reliably, partly because very good design, and we have got very skilled manpower. Next slide. Of course, nuclear has applications everywhere, anything. We are able to export Alfonso mangoes to the United States because we can delay the ripening by radiation. Water resources, we can tell you, we have used some of these isotope hydrology techniques. Food security. If seeds are exposed to radiation, there are mutations. And these mutations, once they are stable and they are cleared by the varietal release programs, the Department of Agriculture, a number of such things which have gone all over India. Diagnostic, somebody has a thyroid problem, drink a water containing radioactive iodine can take a scan, or lung problem, scan with technetium. Babatron can kill cancer cells by radiation, and so on. There is practically a variety of applications which go beyond just producing nuclear power. Next one. See, this for example, see, India is a huge country. Sometimes we forget that. And our technology needs range from nuclear and space to rural. And when I was the PSA, I was very much interested in rural development. We had started this RUTAG program, Rural Technology Action Group. And once when I was in Uttarakhand, I was told that off rainy season, there is a terrible water shortage in Uttarakhand. So they build what are called khals on top of the hill. It's like a pond in which they collect rainwater. And that water seeps through broken rock and goes to the villages where there are aquifers. But what Anil Joshi asked me was, how do I know that it will go to the useful villages, villages where there are aquifers and not to useless places? I said, I'll bring in the BRC with the isotope hydrology technique. They look at this oxygen 18-16 ratio, heavy hydrogen ratio, this environmental tritium. And then they showed the water is trying to flow this way. You put subsurface dikes, the water will flow the way that you want. And the average recharge of the aquifers has gone up by several times. And this aquifer you see had actually dried up. Now it is giving plenty of water. Next slide. Technology management. There is something called technology management, very important for us. Genos and all those in the corporate sector, they use this technology strategy, assessing the role of technology in manufacture. Manufacture which is assures quality as well as speed in operations. You have to maximize interactions with academia so that you have R&D transfer, technology research collaboration, innovation support. I mean, the management must have the mindset to support innovation and provide and encourage leaders in innovation. Ability to develop technology roadmap using technologies, business and market reach, using the new digital technologies and technology foresight. Technology forecasting is trying to tell which science and technological thing will go up in time, which technology will come up. If you forecast, that is forecasting, what will come up in the future. But if you add to it assessments based on economic, social, environmental, security, and perhaps even ethical points of view, it will come to things like human cloning. From a national perspective, it becomes technology foresight. And this makes us decide what are the technologies which are important for our country, our country's needs, based on our country's resources, perhaps our own special skills. And this may differ from one country to another, may also differ depending on the stage of development of the country. Next one, please. Technology management and leadership, all these projects. I'm coming to more or less the end. I think Mani is getting worried. Professor Mani?
No, not at all. Please go ahead, sir.
You see, when you do multidisciplinary projects, if you're a large institution like a Department of Atomic Energy or Space, you find all the component disciplines are available at one place. But if you do the Pokhran test, for example, DAE, DRDO, and armed forces are involved because we brought in complementary capabilities. Design of the nuclear weapons was done in the Department of Atomic Energy, BAC. But the explosive side, the lenses, and other things came from. And of course, later, this has to be integrated into the missiles. Then, of course, I started this program for advanced ultra supercritical thermal plants, because we talk of nuclear and renewable and carbon capture and storage. Next 30 years, you are going to burn coal. And if you can take the temperature of the steam to higher and higher levels, efficiency goes more. And for the same amount of power that you produce, you emit less carbon dioxide. This is what is meant by advanced ultra supercritical thermal plant. And of course, for this, you must bring together talent clusters. Next slide. And of course, you must get good connectivity. It's a very interesting book. Many of you would have read it by this Noah Harari, Homo Deus, Brief History of Tomorrow. And he says, humans nowadays completely dominate the planet. Not because the individual human is smarter and more nimble-fingered than individual chimpanzee or the wolf, but because Homo sapiens is the only species on Earth capable of cooperating flexibly in large numbers. And in fact, that's where your management comes in. And this cooperation is enhanced by electronic connectivity. That's why we have the National Knowledge Network. Communication, the foundation of cooperation. It used to be spoken, it used to be written, and now it is electronic and digital growing. Next one. And artificial intelligence everywhere, from nuclear power and to commerce and cybersecurity, to the medical field, drug design and diagnosis. But there are some people who are scared of long-term developments, like the famous astrophysicist Stephen Hawking. He felt that the development of full artificial intelligence could spell the end of the human race. I don't agree. I agree more with Sir Roger Penrose, who concludes that humans will always be smarter than computers or computer algorithms and any other cybernetic machines that they create. I agree with that. Next one. See, take a case like Ramanujan, Srimas, the magical genius, as he has been called. And there is a book on Ramanujan called The Man Who Knew Infinity. And this review of this Professor Ezekiel Dror, he says people are talking of super intelligent robots. But he says no enhancement of human intelligence, what he means using artificial means, can open the door to becoming a Ramanuja. And no algorithm is too likely to produce any robot with the abilities of Ramanuja. So this is, he says, nobody knows how Ramanujan's mind, my brain worked. That is the conclusion of this beautiful review of the book on Srinivas Ramanujan. Next slide. Cybersecurity, you have to be worried about. See, the more you connect, the better it is, as I also mentioned. But as Leon Panetta said in US Defense Secretary, that the next Pearl Harbor for the US may be cyber-based. Because the most, if you take any system in a developed country, power grid, transportation, financial networks, they're all interconnected. And it's a question of who's smarter. How do you protect these from cyber attacks? Of course, artificial intelligence is helping us to produce better cyber tools, but the crooks are also learning from artificial intelligence and machine learning and so many other areas that we have. This morning, sharing the board for the IIT Jodhpur, Board of Governors, and the lady, young lady was explaining how facial recognition can be corrupted and the video corrupted using deep fakes. Can't even make out what is true and what is a fake in many of the next one. See, finally, I come to the end more or less. Technology is power. There's a famous futurologist, Alvin Toffler, many decades back. He said yesterday, violence was power. Today, wealth is power, and tomorrow, knowledge will be power. Now I paraphrase, I analyze this statement. Why was violence power? Whoever had the best technology for inflicting violence was the most powerful. Holds today also. Why was wealth power later? Whoever had the wealth, the money to convert knowledge into technology became the more powerful. Technology again. And why will knowledge will be power? Because knowledge is the one who at least should technology. What is common to all this technology? So I paraphrase Alvin Toffler to say technology is power. And because it is so, technology domination is sought by countries and companies through the mechanisms of intellectual property rights and technology control regimes. Now, if we want India to be a global technology leader, India should be in the forefront in creating IPRs and make itself immune to technology control regimes, like we have done, as I mentioned, in the nuclear field. And I mentioned about risk-taking. Companies want to be leaders in new advanced technologies. They must have the stomach for being the first introducer of new advanced technology. Sometimes it may fail. 9 out of 10 innovations fail, but that one innovation, he makes enough money to compensate for all the loss. Of course, you must take care of techno-economic viability. You can take care of the importance of the technology, the safety, all those things. But if you are going to wait for proven technology, let somebody else do it, let him prove everything, then you are permanently relegated to the status of a follower. Because I often say that proven technologies, unless subjected to continuous evolutionary improvements, are often a synonym for obsolete technology. And certainly a leader doesn't want to base his development on obsolete technology. Next one. I think that's to thank you all for your patient hearing. I'm through. Professor Mani.
Thank you so much, sir. That was very, very enthralling. We almost felt at some stage we were not only listening to all your wisdom, but the entire Wikipedia of knowledge, if I might use that word, was flowing nonstop from your side. A lot of us got wonderful perspectives of how nuclear energy, atomic energy, science and technology actually affects us day to day as part of our lives. It was really wonderful listening to you, sir. And with your permission, if we can take a couple of questions from the audience.
Thank you, sir. I take the questions, I can't guarantee the answers. Yes.
Right, sir. I'm guaranteeing the answers on your behalf. And on that note, I'd request first Indrapal Singh ji. He has an observation. Over to you, Indrapal ji.
Dr. Chidambaram, wonderful presentation. Thank you so much for it. And I hope you'll be sharing the slides with us as well.
Yeah.
So that we can read those books that you have mentioned there. My question is that in our total energy generation, how come the share of nuclear is about 5% or 7% or something like that? Can nothing more be done to increase the share to say 15 or 20%? So that we can meet net zero targets by 2050?
See, I'll come to the second part of your question in a moment. But you see, we want money. The more money you give, the more plants I can build. But it so happened that India has got a good coal reserve. So early days, we went for coal-based thermal plants. At that time, of course, there was no question of any climate change threat. And at that time, nobody will build a nuclear power plant very near a coal mine. But as you go further and further away from the coal mine, to the cost of coal, you have to add the transportation cost. And this transportation cost is the quantity, considering the quantity, subject also to inflation. Whereas the amount of fuel that is used in the nuclear plant is relatively a smaller amount, the quantity wise. So they used to give clearance for building a power plant only at such a distance from the coal mine so that the unit energy cost of the two become comparable. And now for the first time, this new government has come, they have given in what we call a fleet mode, clearance for 10 700 megawatt reactors at one stroke. Because, if you are a company which supplies to us like Bharat Heavy Electrical or even Larsen & Toubro, You can't give them orders one by one. They are not interested because you have set up the entire assembly line and you have to wait for the next order. So hopefully the capability is there, and we have the three-stage program starting with the pressurized heavy water reactors. And then as we go along, we'll build the second stage based on plutonium and finally based on thorium. Now we are only waiting for more money to be available. Capability is there, it's all indigenous. Not only atomic energy, we have got a lot of industry which provides us Kirloskars and Larsen & Toubro and Bharat Heavy Electrical and so many others who are supplying components to that. You know, you mentioned about, the question is, what is equity in terms of carbon dioxide emission? My impression of equity is everybody in the world must have the same right for per capita greenhouse gas emission or carbon dioxide gas emission. See, what the Americans do and the Western countries do, see, anything per capita in India multiplied by our population looks large, good or bad per capita parameter. And our per capita carbon dioxide emission is 1 by 10 of the US. And so you cannot bring us down. You let us give. See, whatever we talk about the other sources of energy, our per capita carbon dioxide is going to grow for some time. What the government has promised in Copenhagen, is that for every unit of GDP production, we will reduce the amount of carbon dioxide that we use. What we call carbon intensity, we will reduce. But let them come down. Those countries have really, those they have to switch to renewables and nuclear and do other things. And when they go for replacement of their, of course, natural gas emits relatively lower carbon dioxide than coal burning plant. India has a plan for also to go for natural gas.
Right, sir. The next interesting question pertains to one of the points you made, that today, security of information transmitted on the net and through the web is still a question mark. There are lots of threat to information security. What would you believe is the future? Will there be more robust systems to ensure that transmission of such sensitive data is well managed?
See, you have to use electronic communication. There is no way now, because so much of data has to be transmitted. Now, see, cyber attack depends upon the value of the damage that you can cause. Suppose I send you an email, no? What is the point in hacking that information? Okay, you can know when my lecture is, you can get to know for. So this is the one now. This amount, there is a certain amount of cost to hacking. And that cost has to be proportionate or much as a, has to be a fraction of the damage that you can do. You have to protect yourself. And there are plenty of people working in India. I myself started a society of electronic transactions and security in Chennai, which comes under the office of the principal scientific advisor. We are looking at all the techniques in order to protect data, for example, banking data, your personal data. These are all simple techniques are to encrypt, which is the basic thing that you have to do, encrypt. And you must not allow, and this the government is also trying, some of the social media networks to access personal data, which can be misused. Some data which is very important, and then you can add fake onto it, deep faking is what I mentioned earlier also. So our techniques of protection are going to go up, and they are going up. And any protection involves a cost. You have to decide how much are you willing to spend on protecting the information and the transmission of information that you have. The ultimate will come from quantum computers. See, normal RSA or whatever type of coding depends on digital, zero or one. But in quantum, you can have qubits, which can be very large qubits. The keys, the keys can be based on quantum bits. And then you do the normal transmission. And anybody cuts in, then automatically the thing is broken. The chain is broken. There are methods. People are, of course, as I said, the crooks are also getting smarter. Particularly when you have power networks or transportation networks, or you know, air transport networks, you have to spend a lot of money on protecting this kind of. And you must, there are methods also of redundancy, multiple redundancy, so that you don't go by just at one time. Even in the earlier days, for everything in the old Canadian reactor, we had three. If one fails, we don't act. Two out of the three must fail. Some, of course, these are nothing very universal. It has depends on what you have to do. But you know, with the Internet of Things, everything getting connected, it's very convenient. You are a lazy fellow. As you come home, you switch on your microwave 10 minutes before you reach home, so that your food is warm. But your enemy can hack into it and switches on 10 minutes after you've left the office. And you know what will happen to all your food. Those are the minor ones.
I understand.
One can take examples from major ones. But this is a continuous context. Is there time to tell you a story about Edgar Allan Poe? No time.
No, welcome, sir. Let's listen to it.
No, there was one of the greatest mystery writers like Edgar Wallace. And he wrote this following. The two young girls playing even or odd. Two young girls playing even or odd. This girl knows. Last time she put odd, this time she will put even. But if that girl is smarter than this girl, she knows she's expecting even after odd, so I'll put odd after odd. But this girl is smarter than that girl. She would know. She will think I'll go for even after odd, and she would have worked it out. I'll go odd. This is an infinite series. Because Edgar Allan Poe didn't write it in the context of cybersecurity, but the message is exactly the same. The question is, who gets smarter than whom? And you must be prepared to spend a lot of money on cyber security and protecting yourself from cyber attacks. Have alternate sources. You cannot, things cannot be. Always have databases. Don't put it in only one place. Simplest way is to corrupt it. Then your data is gone. Keep it redundant. And so many other simple, those are simpler techniques. But there are very powerful techniques using supercomputers, which can be used to protect information. Yes, sir.
Sure, sir. I think we understand the concept as you explained it so beautifully and so lucidly. I now pass on to Mr. M.D. Agarwal. He's been in technology for many years, ex-TCS, and again, a past president of BMA. Over to you, Agarwalji. Go ahead.
Dr. Chidambaram, it's always a pleasure to listen to you, sir. Last time I met you in CSI, when we invited you to inaugurate the CSI research transactions node. S.P. Raghavan and Mahalingam that time.
Yes.
And it got back me the sweet memories of learning from all the time from you. It was excellent to learning last 55 minutes.
Yes.
That blockchain, in my opinion, may be a part answer to the cybersecurity.
Absolutely. I agree with you. Blockchain is a good solution.
Yeah.
Then you can, you can also counter that. Anyway, you know that as well.
Yeah, so blockchain, somehow we are not finding a very great phase of blockchain in the cryptocurrencies, whatever the reason, but I think the future is bright. I always believe in that. And one question, sir, I want to ask you about this hydrogen. Our country is full of the knowledge and the people like you, the great scientists, I think investment is also not so, one thing I will say, it is available. And we have seen that in the past that, whenever these new opportunities come, we fall back. We fall back. And now Prime Minister has constituted a very special task force, Mukesh Ambani and you know some of the oil companies, and you know to now take a lead in the hydrogen space. Hydrogen is going to be, as we know, that is one of the alternative fuels. Sir, as a management association or as a manager, I will say, you know, what will be the challenge, you know, in front of this business community or business managers, so that we should not lose this race of hydrogen, you know, and you know we should come out in next 3 to 5 years time with an alternative fuels like hydrogen.
The alternate fuel is absolutely right. Hydrogen. See, we are also going for electric vehicles for as an alternate. And I've always thought a hybrid we can start with. Many years back, I've suggested that is stop and start to use electric. And this is from Pune. A company was making something and attach it to the bottom of your car for something like 60,000 rupees. Hydrogen. And you see, the people, there are many people, including some of my friends in BHU and other places, who have run auto rickshaws and cars with hydrogen fuel. It is possible. The question is, of course, one can take care of safety. Hydrogen, whenever one handles, of course, these are things one could, and because you can store hydrogen in material, release it slowly so that the question of hydrogen explosion is not a serious issue. So I think hydrogen is a good, only one has to work out the economy of that, and the recharging the material with hydrogen, just like you have got charging systems for electric vehicles. All those things have been worked out, but it will emerge as an alternative, depending on people who like to have hydrogen vehicles. Certainly, we'll have to wait and see the evolution. Because for 20 years, my friend Professor Owen Srivastav at BHU has been working on hydrogen fuel. And many others have also. They have also developed new materials for storing hydrogen.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Yeah.
So there's another question, and this is mainly seeking your opinion. Do you believe science and spirituality can go hand in hand?
See, I believe in Advaita Vedanta, Advaita, no? Advaita, as Swami Vivekananda also said, is the ultimate philosophy, Advaita. You know, if you ask yourself, who or what ensures that forces between atoms in my animate body, in this table, and in a galaxy a billion light years away are the same. You as a human try to organize something which is stable over a very limited period of time, you realize it is so difficult. And this is where, let me switch a little bit to Kurt Gödel's incompleteness theorem in mathematics. In science, in physics, we set up a set of axioms. And all we can say is all my observations so far are not contradictory to these axioms. What Kurt Gödel shows, mathematically, you cannot prove these axioms unless you go outside the system. And you cannot go outside the system. Now, put all these things together. So my feeling, my personal feeling, between science and spirituality, there is a boundary which cannot be crossed. Religious people say these things are logical, but that is different from the science as we practice it here. And the only combined thing which makes it self-consistence is Advaita. Of course, then one can play around. I remember when I'm talking about 1965, when I had gone for the first time to the Oak Ridge National Lab, they asked me to give a talk to the high school students. They were very smart students, most children of scientists working in Oak Ridge National Lab. And they have been coached what to ask this Hindu fellow. And one girl asked, you see, we believe in one son of God, Jesus Christ. You have got so many thousands of gods. Do you believe in all of them? No? I said, I'll answer your question, but I will draw a figure on the board. You answer my question. I put a thick dot, wrote proton, drew a big circle, put electron there. I ask you, what is it? They say hydrogen atom. They are smart children. I told them, are you sure this is the hydrogen atom? Chorus from the student. Yes, this is the hydrogen atom. I repeat the question. Then they say, what is this fellow? Doesn't know the hydrogen atom. Coming and working in the national lab. Then I ask them, what is the size of the hydrogen atom? Then they knew, one angstrom. What is the size of the figure I have drawn here? 3 feet in diameter. And I asked you repeatedly, you never told me this represents the hydrogen atom. You said this is the hydrogen atom. Then the teachers get into a act because they know they have been trapped now. Then they say, how can you represent one angstrom on the board? That's why we represent like this. So I said, that is the thing. If you can represent in the highest philosophy, if you can imagine it in the abstract, you don't need these tools, these to support you. But these are all paths to support you. Finally, you lead to the same thing. Whether it's Jnana Yoga or Bhakti Yoga or whatever yoga you use, Jnana, Bhakti, Akarma Yoga. Eventually, it means the same thing. And eventually, the ultimate, I think, is beyond religions. You asked a good question. You mentioned spirituality. And I think Advaita is about differentiated religion.
Great, sir. We know that we are running out of time, and we respect the fact that you have taken time off on a working day for us. To move towards the conclusion of this wonderful learning session, I'd like to hand over to Mr. Ernest Fernandez. He has an observation to make, and I'd like to also request him on all our behalf to make a few concluding remarks for this session. Mr. Fernandez, please.
Thank you, Professor Mani. Dr. Chidambaram, you highlighted, and very rightly so, the role of leadership in sustainable development and developing a knowledge economy. But if you look at our country, which is independent for over 70 years, our leadership of Mahatma Gandhi had quite different views on technology and on national security. And you quoted Gandhi as an example of character building. And then we went into the Nehruvian era, where Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru had different views on the public sector and its growth and sustaining the economy, and also on the military and so on. And then we have other views on it, with different political parties assuming the leadership of India. So is that a cause for concern? Because unless we are all agreed as to the role of technology and the role of the military and national security, we will keep on changing our policies depending on which government comes into power.
You are asking a question or you are...
No, I'm just making an observation. And okay. So you need not respond to it.
I can respond if you like.
Yeah. So it leaves the people of India rather not very clear as to what exactly is the role of technology advancement in terms of resources.
Tell me, Professor, Dr. Fernandez.
Yeah.
Is Charkha a technology?
Charkha. Yeah.
Gandhi was spinning.
Yeah.
It is technology.
Yeah.
You know, your cotton, you're converting it into a thread.
Yeah.
Only he didn't call it. He chose to call it by some other name. But you know, as times evolve, is it possible? The question is it possible for India to grow without technology? You can talk about spirituality, you can talk about asceticism, you can always say Indians have less requirements than some of these Western people who are with their whatever methods of styles of living. But to my mind, call it by whatever you want. You see, you will take the sustainable development goals which are given by here. No hunger. You have to produce food. Was Green Revolution, which Swaminathan following Borlaug started in India, that was a kind of technology. Dwarf varieties of wheat, which were not susceptible to be blown away by the wind. To my mind, that is also technology. But that is the one, or similar things, mutations created or selected from natural ones, which will be, to my mind, these are agricultural technologies. No hunger. Good health and well-being. Any drug that you take today, whether it's an antibiotic or any drug today, is based on new methods of treating these things. So, to my mind, it's a bit of a semantic problem. At that point of time, and I have great respect for Gandhiji. Gandhi, I have, in fact, seen him. You might not have seen him. I have seen him when my father was in Meerut. He took me to this in Indian National Congress meeting. Nehru was there. Gandhi was there. Talking in that in the early days. But you know, at any point of time, we have to be competitive in the world. Whether you like it, whether it is in a way, if you want. See, there are various ways in which one can decide to live one's life. I need minimum without compost. I have a house, live there, my food. If I get an infection and die, well, sorry about it. But this is what I want. I go a little further, I live in a better house. I need air conditioning. I go to a doctor, I take antibiotics, take myself COVID vaccine, wait for the second shot as I'm doing. One shot is over, wait for the second one. So it is where it goes. Now it depends on what? I don't know what it depends. So many, too many factors are involved. The way one lives and one needs. We can continue the debate, Mr. Fernandez. I'm happy to duel with you further.
I'm sure we'll find an occasion for that also, sir. On that note, on behalf of every one of us present, including all the executive committee members of BMA, all the past presidents, and every participant, the least I could say is that you enthralled us not only with your wisdom, but your wit and your ability to respond to situations and the amount of references, as Indrapalji said, you shared with us, I think will keep us busy for the next couple of weeks if we sit down to further research. And I'm confident that you will continue to be the icon and the torchbearer for research. And we hope India produces more and more scientists and ensures that our country becomes a superpower in the knowledge economy, as we had discussed today. Very grateful to you, sir. It's been a privilege to host you on the BMA platform on this very special occasion. May I request all our colleagues to put on their videos so that we can capture a group photograph with Dr. Chidambaram, which will serve as a pleasant memory of the wonderful interaction that we've had over the past 1 hour with him this evening. Everyone, please put on your videos. Allow our secretariat to take the digital photograph. We have Lakshmi, Supriya, Oindrula, Deepa, all of them very efficient woman power of the Bombay Management Association, who also double up as digital photographers. That's something that they have learned in the last 1 year. As I mentioned, for BMA, this has been a very unique year. BMA has delivered its entire programs in the last 1 year, starting April 1 to today, on the digital platform. So as we officially sign off for this fiscal, with the assurance that BMA will continue this digital journey, perhaps with a physical journey too, because I know that we are all stuck between lockdown and unlock and various things that are going around us. But I'm confident that learning is a process that will go on forever. Thank you everybody for your continuous presence over the last 100 plus events of various forms that we have done. And we look forward to be learning forever, as I said. Thank you, Dr. Chidambaram, sir. It was indeed our honor and we are humbled that you chose to spend this time with us this evening.
No, thank you. Thank you, Professor. It's a pleasure. Also, two wonderful questions so that I could interact with you, with all of you. Great pleasure.
Thank you, sir. Good evening, everybody. Stay safe, stay blessed, and meet up sometime in the near future. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you.